four by six. It's 7:02, and I'll call the order, this meeting of the Middlebury Development Review Board for February 28th, 2017. First thing, I'll go briefly over the agenda. It will be public communications, approval of minutes, three business items, an application by Mylet Real Estate for a PUD amendment, and a conditional use review for a multi-unit apartment building in South Village PUD on Court Street, an application by Benjamin Detman for a conditional use approval to add business professional office as a use to 2 Park Street, and then the DRB will have an informal conversation about the Beneker permit, and then deliberative session if needed, and then other business. If you wish to be a interested party, would you please sign in your name and address? And at this point, on any of the business items, are there any conflicts from the board?
I will recuse number 3.
Okay. All right. So the approval of minutes for November 14th, 2016. Is there a motion to approve the minutes?
So moved.
Is there a second?
I'll
second the motion.
We need to change the date on line 17.
To 10:20.
What's wrong with 17?
On line 17, the date should be what?
10:24:16. These are the minutes for 11:14:16 that we're approving.
No.
That's what mine says.
Mine says 11:14. Mm-hmm. And we weren't.
At the what the
oh,
motion is to approve the minutes of November 14th.
Right.
The first item of the minute says minutes of November 14th couldn't be approved. It should say minutes of October 24th couldn't be approved on November 14th.
She's right. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. It was a typo.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
The wrong date in. Yeah.
Yeah.
10.
Gotcha.
That should be what? 10?
10:24:16.
24. Okay.
Thanks, Ann.
Right here. Okay.
Good. Any other changes or comments? All in favor of the approval of the minutes of November 14, 2016? Say aye.
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 Aye. Opposed?
Absent.
Okay. Abstaining?
Will be absent.
Okay, is there a motion to approve the minutes of December 12, 2016?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Move the second. Discussion, changes, comments? Hearing none. All in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Absent.
Absent?
I was absent, too.
Okay. Okay. The minutes for February 13th. Is there a motion?
I was absent.
So moved.
Okay. Moved. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Okay. Discussion, comments, changes? All in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Absent.
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 Okay. All right. First item on the business agenda is an application by Mylet Real Estate for a PUD amendment and conditional use review of a multi-unit apartment building in South Village PUD on Court Street. The parcel number is 07009, and the property is located in the Village Residential Commercial Zoning District. And before we proceed...
Hey, Brett. There's another order of business here that would be quicker if you're waiting for your architect anyway.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay.
Yeah.
Could I make a suggestion?
Yes, Jen, yes.
Could we switch the order of the first two agenda items and hear Ben Stepman first?
Sure.
Okay.
Is that all right with the board?
I was going to suggest that, but she beat me to it.
All right, so we'll go back to the agenda.
I was thinking that was your architect. Kind of looks architectural.
We'll review...
No.
So our second business agenda, an application by Benjamin Detman for a conditional use approval to add business professional office as a use to 2 Park Street. The parcel is number 24066, and the property is in the Central Business District. Okay. Now, if you'd like to come forward, first thing... First thing, I'll administer the oath to applicants and interested persons. I affirm that the evidence and information I am giving in this proceeding is true and accurate to the best of my knowledge and belief.
Yes, I agree.
All right. You'd like to briefly explain your proposal?
Good evening. I know many of you. I'm an attorney. I practice currently at 7 Washington Street at Detman and Foley, PC, and my wife and I are both attorneys in that law firm, and we are affiliated with Jim Foley and his wife Stephanie Foley, and the Detmans have decided to take their practice out of the current location at 7 Washington Street to another location. Elmwood Properties LLC is the owner of 2 Park Street, and the principal of Elmwood Properties is Barney Hodges. And Barney and I have discussed his property where there's a location Middlebury Mountaineer currently occupies that is in the process of moving out. I think that location would be a very good location for a law firm, and the square footage is suitable for what my wife's and my needs are, and we think it would make a great location for a law firm. In a nutshell, that's it.
Okay.
But it's obviously currently used as retail, so to switch to a professional office, I think in that district we need a permit to allow the change. We also need a signed permit, so I applied for that.
So the parking requirements, Jen, would be less under his proposed use than the so that's not an issue with parking?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, I checked with Ted. That's the precedent for changes of occupancy in downtown.
Right.
Is there any on-site parking at that location currently?
There is. There's current Middlebury Mountaineer currently has 2 spaces dedicated behind the building on the property that are it. For its sole use. Barney and I discussed actually how those 2 spaces could be doubled up and we'd be parking somebody in, but that could happen under certain circumstances. And then there's actually some reworking of the property that could be done to expand the parking someday, but that's not currently contemplated. Uh-huh. But I do think there's suitable on-site parking for us.
And even though you meet the requirements, are you willing to tell us how many employees, including yourself and your wife, you anticipate having there?
At the outset, there will be 4 of us,
uh-huh.
2 attorney and 2 staff.
Thank you.
And you are aware of the municipal parking lot down in the alley?
Oh, yes.
I thought you did, but I just thought I'd mention that. Well, like I tell people, if you can't find a place, they're not going to come and see you, so that's your problem.
That'd be my problem.
That's right. So,
as a procedure question, are we considering the change of use for the parcel, not the particular? It's defined by the boundary, right? So the whole building property.
That's true. So the decision to allow a law office there will be bound to that whole parcel, which includes other uses as well.
Yeah.
But you can have more than one use for a parcel.
But there currently is renters upstairs, correct?
Right. There's residential properties above.
Right.
And on the same ground.
Which is office. So it's going to become an office apartment, though, right?
There's still one retail space in there. Dan Freeman's Leatherworks. It's been there for 30, 25 years. So, you know, guess I, with regard to your question, David Hamilton, what you're asking is, would the parcel be then retail, office, and residential?
Yeah, I guess I just wanted to put a fine distinction, I just wanted to get into the distinction that, we're not just approving the space, which the applicant is subleasing. We're approving a change of use, in addition to the potential uses for the parcel. That's all it's pointing out.
Well, if the existing apartments were converted to business offices, wouldn't that be a change of use from that? And he would have to apply for a permit to do that.
Mm-hmm.
So this application is really going with just the space that he's renting.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Okay. Questions? I'll just go through some of the elements, and there's no change to outdoor lighting, no impact on the wetlands. There'll be no additional landscaping. Stormwater is not a problem. We've discussed the parking. The traffic access remains unchanged. You have sufficient water and wastewater availability. So those are all clear cut. There are any other questions at this time from the board?
I'm going to make a motion.
Before you do that, are there any comments from the public at this time? Hearing none.
I move the Middlebury Development Review Board, having reviewed the application submitted and having heard and duly considered the testimony presented at the public hearing on February 28, 2017, approves the conditional use request for a change of use for the property, and it says on the property located at 2 Park Street for retail store at the law offices. So I want to make sure that that language covers, that seems like it talks about the whole piece of property and not just a section of the property.
Is there a number? Is there a number for that property?
Do you have the number? The town parcel?
Oh, it's like
no. Oh. What he's going to rent?
Suite.
Unit?
No, it's
five or?
It's the Middlebury Mountaineer space. It's their address. So 2 Park Street.
2 Park Street.
2 Park Street covers it. But
unit one, unit two? Yeah.
We don't want to cover it for the whole.
Right. I mean, there is a unit one and there's a unit seven, but there is not one unit for that space, I'm sorry to say. We could make one up.
Will this be the, this rental, will this cover the first floor of the whole building?
No.
No.
Just the left.
Just that space. That's a good point. I have not created a unit for that space.
You got a post office box?
No.
The mailing address for the Middlebury Mountaineer is the Middlebury Mountaineer 2 Park Street.
We can amend that.
But I'm sorry.
As the person who may have kicked this hornet's nest, I should just say that I didn't have anything in the back of my mind that I was really terrified about happening here.
No.
I just wanted to be clear. Is it a suite of building
right.
or a property? And
right.
I think we take action on property primarily.
So one property can have a whole host of different uses on it. So this is just one change of use for the property located at 2 Park Street. And that's what that motion should say. For a change of use, if you guys are okay with it, for a change of use for the property located at 2 Park Street. So you're going to take one of your uses, you know.
You could call it, if you wanted to, you could call it
unit
commercial
one.
Space A, and commercial space B is Dan Freeman's space, you know.
Not to interrupt you, but this is not the direction we want to go in.
Okay.
It's just, I mean, you'd probably agree being an attorney. It's just a change. One of the uses is going to change to a different use, and he's still going to have a whole bunch of different uses.
Okay.
It's like Monopoly. You got the car and the hat and all that, but
I'm
it's
just,
the same.
Okay.
Unchecked the hornet's nest.
Is your proposed motion okay?
Yes, for a change of use for the property located at 2 Park Street.
Okay.
I will second Don's motion.
Okay. It's been moved and seconded. Further discussion on the motion? Hearing none, all in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? One not voting.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So there's no waiting period on this, is there, Jennifer? Is there a waiting period? The 30 days?
Yeah, we have 30 days to put the decision together.
We got to get Steve Atosha out first.
Okay, well.
We've got plenty of time.
We're good.
I'm just kidding.
But I was reading the Independent today, it said that they're moving to another location on Main Street.
Yeah, but it's going to take a while, so it's fine. There's no rush.
Okay. I think that the fact that this happened tonight will give us plenty of time. Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you.
Have a good evening.
Okay. The next business agenda is an application by Mylan Real Estate for a PUD amendment and conditional use review of a multi-unit apartment building in South Village PUD on Court Street. Parcel number is 07009, and the property is located in the Village Residential Commercial Zoning District. Okay, if you'd like to come forward, and if you, I'll give you the oath again. And anybody that wants to testify, I affirm that the evidence and information I am giving in this proceeding is true and accurate to the best of my knowledge and belief. This is you.
Good evening. My name is Brent Rakowski. I'm with Otter Creek Engineering. We are the civil engineer representing Mylan Realty. I'm here with Brett Grabowski, who is representing Mylan Realty. And the proposal before you is an amendment to the Middlebury South Village PUD for a change from what was previously approved, which was 16 townhomes, to a 40-unit apartment building. And those units are broken into roughly an even split between one and two-bedroom units. And the building, as you may know, in the plan set that was provided, the building is being designed to really occupy what was once previously the original kind of concept for the South Village project site. It was a larger commercial office building that was actually occupying, if you've been out to the site, a lawn space that's currently there in between the village. If I can stand up.
Sure, that'd be great.
Right. This is currently South Village Green that runs here. Mm-hmm. It's a one-way road.
Yeah.
And then you'll note the state office building and double stack parking here.
Right, could you stand just back a little? Don't move the screen.
I gotcha. I'm looking right at the screen there. Okay.
Thanks.
I can reach around the corner.
Good, that's great.
So the you know, there's currently parking here, and I don't believe this is striped currently for parking. But again, the original concept, for those who maybe recall, with the South Village project, was this parcel was intended to be an office type retail building. And the last go around where we came before the town through Retrovest and Village Walk intended to modify this area, do some reconfiguration of the drives, actually, and what ended up happening is some reconfiguration of the green space that was currently out there today. So under this proposal, really what we're doing is reverting back to what was the original concept behind South Village. Having done that, there are a number of things that make this somewhat easier from an engineering perspective. The water and sewer utilities are already there. The stormwater treatment pond, which is to the left on the screen there of the larger of the building, which is shaded, those were all anticipated as part of that original South Village design and permitting. So really what we're doing, at least on the somewhat on the state level, is just making some minor amendments that were necessary because the last go around we had to change them for the configuration for Village Walk, if you follow me.
Yes.
So the proposal by Mylan is from a utility standpoint, we're looking at water and sewer connections that are right to the building themselves. There's not a lot of infrastructure that's needed, infrastructure expansions. stormwater will be treated in accordance with the state standards, and the traffic flow goes back somewhat to the original concept that was envisioned for South Village. And you know, I guess other than that, from a civil engineering standpoint, I think that's as much as I can speak to. I'd be happy to answer any questions that you may have. Again, Brett is here. We can talk more about that. The project was reviewed with the DAC, and I don't believe there were any substantive comments that came from that. I think it was a pretty positive meeting between the two. And again, if you have any questions, I can certainly help with that.
Okay. Don.
So from the 16 original units that was going to be on this parcel of land, my understanding is some of that was going to be geared to more senior housing originally. I sat on that.
Yeah. I don't recall specifically. I know that it was a mixture of
right.
housing and accessibility to some of those units, but I don't know the specific numbers.
So I guess my question is if we were to occupy that with 16 townhouses, what would have been the average number of people living in that complex versus now a 40-unit complex with half being two-bedroom and half being one-bedroom? Is there a significant more travel coming in and out of there because of the number of people now using this? I mean, I guess my question is, and I'm going to refer this to people on the board, is that at some point in time, somebody's going to trip the trigger as to who's going to pay for the light when the property becomes so saturated you can't get in and out of there and becomes unmanageable.
It's already
now,
pardon me? It's already like that. If you want to.
It is.
Left.
So now we're going to make it worse. So what I'm saying, my question is that I'm going to refer to Jennifer. At what point do we say, you know, we need to do something about traffic before we grant another 40-unit apartment house? Just a question. And I'm against development. I'm for development, and I'm good for growth. But, you know, we need to remember that it brings problems with it.
I'll speak.
Sure.
Brent's gonna, I'm Brett Grabowski.
Yep.
Representing Mylot Real Estate here this evening. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to address the board. I understand what your concerns and your point is. I think one of the things that Brent was actually discussing in regards to the civil infrastructure that is there, we are going back to what was originally approved on this site. The original approval on this site was a two-story office building on this location. And I understand concerns about triggering warrants and density and amount of traffic. This is actually one bedroom and two bedroom units from an apartment standpoint is actually a reduction in actually what the original approval was, which was an office use. So that is certainly the impacts to this site, even with this building being 40 units, is actually a reduction of the overall impacts that were approved originally. The project also, in the original approvals, the density or the original residential density that was allowable in this site was actually 42 additional units than what was already built out. So that was obviously taken into account and factored into the original approvals as well in regards to the traffic circulation, the flow, and the densities that were originally allowed. So what we believe is we're using, from a civil and infrastructure standpoint, we're already utilizing what's already been built and what was already proposed. And we feel that the use, being a residential use, half one bedroom and two bedrooms, is actually less of an impact than the original approved plans.
I have just a clarification. Is this set that was included with our packet the set that the DAC saw when I'm reading their minutes?
Yes, it is.
No changes since then?
No.
Can I answer?
Well, I remember there's some discussion, and I know we had talked about a traffic study when this was when it was first requested when the application. And I'm not sure that we ever did get a traffic study with that first proposal. Do you recall that?
If I can, the one thing that you may recall, and I don't know if you were here. here, but...
I was here for that hearing, all the hearings.
Not for the, not necessarily for the original, but for the Village Walk, because under the Village Walk proposal, there was a, another interim traffic study done. And that traffic study indicated that, that the levels were actually less with the resident, with that 16-unit townhouse was less than the original, the original permitted PUD.
Right, but in the meantime, all of those lots have been built out in the circle.
Well, the original study for South Village PUD anticipated that that was full, that was done as a full build-out. There were different scenarios, and one of them was a full build-out scenario.
I can tell you, I've changed banks because I don't like going down there and trying to get in and out of there. So, you know, it's just, somebody's going to pay in the end to make this, we're going to fix a problem that we're creating by having growth. And I'm not against growth, don't get me wrong. But at some point in time, somebody's going to be paying for a light. And I don't want it to be the taxpayers of Middlebury. That's all I'm saying.
Any other questions?
I have a question about parking. We have attached to our packet here a sheet talking about the original MSV layout and one parking study boundary, showing the parking study boundary. One shows 12 parking spaces, parallel parking spaces on the northwest side of the proposed building lot, and the other one shows 25 front in, or however the term is. Which one is contemplated?
The intent behind the two sketches that you're referring to is the first was the original Middlebury South Village PUD, which is showing the front end, the parallel, the perpendicular park.
Right.
Okay. And the intent behind that was to just give a general depiction of, at least my understanding of which the parking that may be associated to the to each particular building. So as I mentioned, underneath the original Middlebury South Village approval, it was an office building, commercial use type building, and that had associated with it, or at least in the immediate vicinity, somewhere in the order of, I think, 75 parking spaces is what I may have shown. Mm-hmm. And then this latest proposal is obviously for residential, one-for-one parking, and again, I attempted to use the same boundary and depict within that boundary how many spaces are provided underneath our current proposal, and that is 62 spaces.
But that boundary that includes the 62 spaces is actually larger than the boundary of the lot that is being purchased, isn't it?
It doesn't include
the 28 spaces.
It does, because all of this is part of one large association, so it is a shared parking design.
Okay.
But actually, to answer your question, it is actually off the particular, there are actually 28 spaces, mm-hmm, that may be actually off the lot boundary.
Okay, thank you.
Another 34, sorry, mm-hmm, I can't see too well. 34 spaces are on lot parking.
So basically you're changing the perpendicular spaces to parallel there.
Right.
So you're reducing these spaces. Parking availability there.
So when you say the project as proposed will provide 62 parking spaces, it's not actually providing 62 parking spaces. It's providing the 12...
The 34.
Right.
Correct. Yeah, I would say that. I think it's important to note that the whole idea behind the parking and the maybe somewhat more of the history of it is that it was intended to be shared parking.
I understand. And given that this is going to be residential, it will actually, hopefully, a number of those people will be getting in their cars and getting out of Creek Road and managing to get to work in the morning, and then those spaces will be available for
The state office.
The state office building or whoever's using some of them now.
That's exactly the shared parking scenario and how it works. And we have a lot of experience with that, many mixed-use projects where it is the residents leave during the day, the commercial uses come in, and it switches in the evening and allows to basically reduce the amount of surface area or amount of hardscape and actual paved parking lots that a project actually requires.
And none of the 30-plus parking spaces that will be new ones will be restricted to tenants?
No. Actually, as you're seeing this right now, the only new parking spaces that are actually being built are the few parallel ones on the upper side. All the other parking already exists, as shown. It's already basically, it's already created.
The part on the southeast side of the building, that's still there, the bottom part.
The bottom part already exists.
Right, okay, thank you.
And the top part, all the straight in, already exist as well.
The building just east of that, I'm not sure if those apartments there, whatever, is there?
They have underground, they have some underground parking.
Yeah, and there is some parallel parking in front or on the west side. I would call it the west side of that building.
Yes, and that's more or less shown from that.
Do you know whether those are apartments or townhouses?
I do not know the exact configuration of that building.
Those are apartments.
Okay.
And that's owned by?
Yeah, it's Housing Vermont Champlain Trust.
It's subsidized housing.
Thank you.
Is that similar to the building just north of?
Deniker?
Deniker?
Same, yes.
Okay.
Same corporation.
Okay.
The approval decision that's issued from 2014 that Jennifer and Victor included in our packet had a couple of points that I wanted to ask about. Numbers, that's this document from the notice of decision from May of 2014. This is the 16 townhomes. So I assume that these findings still apply to this project. I don't know who I'm asking. The approval for the 16 townhomes has these 24 or whatever they are, 20, 28 or something.
I don't think they don't apply because that project was never completed. So I don't think that.
That's my reading of it too, Kevin.
Yeah.
So where I was going was, you know, one of the requirements is for affordable housing, and I know. So if they're not operative or guiding our decision, I still think it's relevant because the project has been advertised as workforce. What is the definition of workforce? It's sort of a term of art, right?
We are, the units will be priced. It depends what you want to use as a definition of affordable housing. It's not really affordable. There's varying degrees. If you're a Champlain Housing Vermont, that is what is something that is subsidized. So basically, they're dealing with state-funded money, helps bring down the basis on the project, and thus they can provide the cost of those units is significantly below median income, sometimes as low as 40%. What we are proposing here is, I believe median income in Addison County is what's roughly 65,000 approximately. So the units that we're proposing here will all be affordable at 100% of median income in Addison County.
So you're not designating any Section 8 housing in this property?
No, we cannot. Section 8 is, we cannot deny Section 8, and we don't deny Section 8. We basically determine our rental is all basically on a financial basis, ability to pay. So if somebody comes to us, say, with a Section 8 voucher, which is typically the voucher programs that exist, if they pass our requirements as far as ability to pay in regards to credit checks and references, then we do not and cannot discriminate.
But using your minimum that you're using for Addison County, you know and I know that they wouldn't qualify.
That's all. Oh, there we go. So That's all based upon how much are they, is that individual subsidized? And that's, that changes from person to person. Because we have in Chittenden County right now, we've actually just taken a couple people just recently that are Section 8, and they are funded either through the state or through federal subsidies. And they have a voucher, and sometimes we provide, a check is sent to us straight from the state or from HUD, and sometimes it's sent directly to them, and they pass on the funds to us.
But a voucher is just a matter of payment. What I'm getting at is there's no capital A affordable housing in this proposal, but when proposals come at market rate, but aiming at a lower price band in the market, the claim is often made that those are workforce and that they do address the community's housing problem if one has been identified as it has been in Middlebury for non-luxury housing. I think, is that accurate?
Yes.
Yeah.
A lot of the subsidized housing Vermont, Burlington Trust, it is restrictive. So if you make, you know, there is an income limit. If you make more than that, then you cannot qualify to occupy those units. So there is a need. Obviously, there's a need in this state for that type of affordable housing, but there's also a significant need in this state just for basic housing for people who are working, you know, working in the banks, working in various areas that they make too much money to qualify for those subsidized units.
I don't want to repeat myself, but to Kevin and to Jennifer, if no action were taken on this application, this would still be in effect, right? This notice of decision? It's not been vacated, it's being replaced tonight.
I don't know, what was the time limit on that?
2014.
It's 2014 was the date of the decision.
No one ever pulled a permit for this.
Okay, so it died? Or it's just, it's alive or it's dead?
Well, you'd have to ask an attorney what the statute of limitations is on a DRB decision. No one pulls a permit. I don't know that off the top of my head.
I guess what I'm getting at is that, you know, somebody who reviewed this before, some of the people who reviewed this before are in this room, and these were attached as findings or conditions. So I...
Are we still talking about the affordable housing thing?
Well, there are a couple of elements in there that are substantial requirements or conditions, I think, on the proposal. And I'm just wondering if those are still things that the DRB wants to put on.
And I would agree with you. If we don't think about affordable housing, we're going to take some hate from some of the community here that think that we need to think about affordable housing as well.
Well, I'd be happy to offer a perspective in the capacity of town planner, having studied the housing data for this region, if that's helpful to you. So when we look at the housing data, you can see from this table here that you know, when you talk about affordable housing, it's like, what do you mean by affordable? Affordable to whom? And so you see that you're still low income if you have a family of four and you're earning $56,800 in this town, which is like a pretty good salary, or like a couple that makes $45,450. So what we've heard from the college, from the hospital, and other large employers is that there's a need for housing for people like me, you know, that maybe aren't making enough to like buy their first house yet, you know, but don't want to live in like college rentals and just want good quality, affordable rental housing near where they work. And so there's just a missing piece in our housing market there. And so if we want to, what the Planning Commission has concluded is that if we want to continue to support our employers, then we need to create housing for workers, you know, workforce housing. So.
But at some point in time, didn't the Planning Commission pretty much tell people that we need to set a portion, there should be so many affordable housing units set aside in every project?
We don't have that kind of zoning here.
We don't have it, but it's been implied that we should be thinking about having affordable housing in all of these particular projects.
Yeah, sure. I mean, definitely there's also a need for affordable housing for people who meet the very low or extremely low income limits,
right.
Like the people who would maybe live in the subsidized apartments directly across the green from this building, but...
If you add 40 housing units at reasonable rents, are you not then potentially freeing up some apartments that are already rented, perhaps at lower rates?
I would go further and say, even if they were at unreasonable rents, they would free up apartments.
Well, right.
So I think there's to me an obvious positive outcome of this project. What I'm getting at is it is not what was put in as a requirement in the last iteration here, mm-hmm. which is that a majority of the housing within the PUD will be within the range of financing eligibility of VHFA, which is the definition of affordable, right?
And that decision doesn't have any influence on this decision unless you want to look at it for ideas.
Okay.
But I will tell you that we don't have inclusionary zoning in this town.
Yep.
So you can't necessarily require that.
Right.
So you could always ask, but...
And one wonders also what impact that requirement had on the failure to pursue a permit.
One might.
If we build, people are going to come here. This is not to take care of the needs in this community. This 40 units is going to fill up very quickly. People are going to move here because it's Middlebury, and they don't have another place to live. It's not going to free up other places, believe me. It's all about economics. They're going to come here because they want to come here.
Any other questions, comments, concerns at this point?
Well, can we go down through some of these elements?
Sure.
outdoor lighting plans. Well, we have 8 new LEDs.
Okay.
Was the question answered that Jen posed in here?
Pardon me?
Are you asking the question that Jen posed in our notes?
Yes, we'll ask that question. If you could go through the lighting plan that you're proposing, that would be helpful.
I'm still thinking about affordable housing. Why are we looking at the lighting plan? My question, Brett and Brent, was about security lighting. And are any of these lights going to remain on all night long?
The parking lot lights, their intention is to stay on.
All night long.
They're on all the time.
Yep. And then how about the wall pack on the
west side? Any lights on the basically building mounted or in the parking lot will remain on.
Okay. So the lighting plan doesn't really show any off-site dispersal of light at all, right?
Yeah, no.
Okay.
It's all within the envelope of the...
That's the photometric plan, what is anticipated. So you see it does not extend beyond the specific parking area, parking needs of the building. And you can see on the small circles at the top, those are actually existing parking lot lights that are already installed. The small little circle. So those will take care of lighting the existing parking spaces that are on that side.
And those are currently on all at night. That's right along the property boundary there, is it?
Yeah. Okay.
Any other concerns on lighting? Okay. Wetlands, waterlands, and conservation areas, I think you've already addressed that under the current approval that you have. Landscaping, screening, and outdoor storage.
Is the landscape as represented in the elevations, landscape at maturity?
Greg can answer.
No, I imagine that they're not thick at this point either.
The design at the design advisory board, they did not have any issues as far as species go. They made some comments about locations and just making sure, you know, there was adequate growth, room for growth.
How tall does a honey, how tall does a honey locust get?
Maturity?
At maturity, 60 feet.
Oh, okay. Would they be able to grow that high with this much impervious surface?
You know, there is a, you know, I'm certainly not an arborist, but they will, anyone will most likely tell you that, you know, a function of how big a tree grows is dependent on the soils that it's growing in, and water and fertilizer and all those conditions. So, you know, how much a tree might may or may not be restricted, I can't answer that question.
Please don't plant any ash trees.
Okay. I don't think you can buy one now, actually, to plant. Yeah.
Well, we're going to be taking them all down.
I know. Well, that's why.
There were some additional comments that came after our packet, and one interested citizen was concerned about open space.
We're actually, you know, by going back to the old plan, mm-hmm. we're providing, the open space was eliminated on the previous plan that was
yes.
approved. And so we're actually going back to the previous plan that had the centralized green area actually in the middle of the project, which I'm sure was a specific requirement of those original approvals.
And they also questioned the parking and...
Yeah, and we just, you know, I think that I read that memo, and their concern is about adequacy of parking.
Yes.
And I think that was...
I think,
you know,
we've answered that. Yeah.
The shared parking situation, I think, is a...
And I think that to that residence issue, I think the proximity of the recreation center and its fields should be noted.
Exactly.
And there are sidewalks basically from this project all the way to the recreational center.
I actually took a ride through Cottage Lane, and those residences are very close together. There isn't much green space for those families in there. And I'm thinking, just to the west, the rec center, all those fields, and even if you went to middle school, that's not that far away.
High schools are right there.
And children don't play in their own gardens anyway, unless their own gardens are 2 or 3 acres large.
Right.
That's not enough space.
I just wanted to address those concerns that were brought
mm-hmm.
up.
Yes.
One of the other questions was school. Any idea how many potential youngsters would live here?
Very, very few. You know, we've done a lot of demographic studies over time because we've dealt with Williston back 15 years ago where that was a problem. It's not now, but one-bedroom units, you're not going to generate any children. Two-bedroom units in an apartment, you know, we're proposing 20 units, and typical numbers are 0.2, 0.3 per unit. So it's very, very, very low numbers. But also, you know, there's no secret that the demographics in this state are changing, and the number of young children are actually decreasing significantly. So
we can basically say we don't expect any big impact to schools.
Okay. Stormwater, we've dealt with. Parking, traffic, access, we've dealt with. Water, wastewater, we've dealt with. We have all our okay. Any other questions right now from the board? Okay, are there any comments, concerns from the public at this point? Hearing none. Okay, I will ask the board what they would like to do. Make a motion to discuss this now or go into closed session to make a decision.
The only other question I have for Jennifer is any issues with the town plan conformance?
I'm going to make the motion. I move the Mulberry Development Review Board, having reviewed the application submitted and having heard and duly considered the testimony presented at the public meeting here of February 28th, approve the PUD amendment and conditional use review of a multi-unit apartment building in the South Village PUD.
It's been a motion. Is there a second to the motion?
Second.
Moved and seconded. Okay, discussion on the motion.
Can Gary second? Are you being a, there's eight of us, there's...
I don't know.
There's only seven on the board.
I knew this was happening.
So none of you abstain. You're abstaining from later.
I'll second it.
Okay, just making sure.
Okay, so...
Does anyone, I mean, I don't, but does anyone need private discussion before we vote?
I don't. Okay, so it's been moved and seconded. So for comments?
The only comments and comments that I would make is that I wanted you to know that I am concerned about affordable housing, and I stress that anybody that wants to be part of this community needs to think about making affordable housing part of our center. So that's, with that being said, I hope that it'll work.
Thank you. Okay, I'll just touch on that. Your comment, Don, is I agree with you, but I also think that this project, when it was developed as a PUD, addressed some of that affordable housing.
It did.
With, right across from this.
Right.
And I think the fact that this is geared toward the working element, which I think is sometimes not got the attention it should have, I think this helps that as well as, you know, we're trying to do affordable housing, but we also need to look at that sector, and I think this is valuable for Middlebury. Any other comments, questions about any of the concerns? Hearing none. All in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Zero. Seven ayes, zero noes, one not voting.
Thank you very much.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
You build it, they'll come.
Yep.
That's for sure. Any particular date or whatever you're going to ask? Whenever. Whenever we see a shovel on the ground.
Well, I'm the last developer. He didn't think it was super.
Is
it
Kevin?
Well, I can make something if you want to stay around.
Kevin?
Yeah, and?
Yes.
You had a question?
No.
Oh, Jen.
I was wondering if, I'm hoping that Tom Deniker shows up tonight. I told him around 8 o'clock we thought we'd be ready for him.
Okay.
Could we spend maybe 5-10 minutes talking about what conditions you'd like to see in this decision, if any, or?
In this decision?
In this one here?
Any particular conditions you want me to put in the decision, or?
Well,
something enforceable?
I mean, you have to.
Well, you like lighting?
If we find.
Yeah, the lighting. We should address the lighting as a condition.
If parking becomes an issue, I mean, I think it all has to still have the ability to, I was taking a look if we need to, but.
I'm sorry.
The one I heard that made me just sort of got my hairs up on the back of my neck was the idea of shared parking being countercyclical between residential and office only works if you do not designate 42 of those spaces as for unit X, Y, and Z.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that the credit we've just given them for that parking resolution would be undone if, in the marketing of these units, they found that they had to sign those, which is very possible in apartment marketing, that people won't buy them or rent them without that. So I think that he said that in the meeting.
That could be, we might have a whole bunch of people that go in there and don't have cars. That's very possible.
Lovely. It is most likely they will have fewer cars than the average person in Middlebury, because that's a great place to locate if you don't want to have a bunch of cars. But I think that because he said it in an open meeting, in our hearing, I think that we should make that a condition that no more than maybe a few handicapped or loading spots may be designated as apartment only.
I heard him tell Ann that this is all shared parking.
Yeah.
So maybe the condition could say something like that. Start out saying it's understood that this is shared parking, and as such, no parking shall be designated as apartment only.
Right. With some sort of way out for it. You'll want to have some loading spaces.
They're
or
marketing this, that they're going to say, oh, we'll have a parking space.
We just recently, like you said, just took the dental office and said, oh, it's okay if there's overflow parking, you can park in the state parking lot. Because I questioned if they were going to have enough parking spaces in there. It met the criteria, but everybody said, doesn't matter, there's a big parking lot about it. The state owns that.
But that's the same idea that these tenants will hopefully have jobs that they'll be going to and not just walk. Well, it would be nice if they walk to their jobs, but they'll probably still have a car. So yeah, ideally, they'll take their car with them to work.
And this countercyclical parking idea does work. It does result in a net reduction of spaces, but only if the person who comes into the office doesn't find the space they're looking for, saying apartment 312.
Right.
Okay. So your point, Dave, is
should we be talking about this without them being here? I mean, I feel awkward.
It was their
here
choice to leave.
Yeah, but I don't think they knew we were going to continue to talk about this application. So I'm just.
Well, okay.
Well, I think it was stated that it would be open parking, basically. So
that's what it said.
That was
I think that's
statement.
How we have
so
to.
So there's no problem confirming that in
them?
The. Well, since they said that, why?
They're still out there.
I'll tell you, the Shaw's is supposed to be open parking. You see signs all over, you know.
No parking. Shaw's customer only.
Who's that?
Shaw's parking lot.
It's the same.
Is it?
I think it's the Marble Works too.
Exactly.
They, you know, they can't tell you. They'll tell you they can, but
they can't.
They can't.
How do they get away with putting the signs up?
They just do it.
Well, why don't we have them take them down?
That's what David's saying, I think.
Well, who's
I think that's what I want to make sure is that there is a condition specific to this that is enforceable. So Justice Jennifer Mike.
So in other words, when the Shaw's parking was organized like that, there should have been such a condition.
Yeah, that's what I'm suggesting.
I see.
Sorry to drag you back.
Do you want me to summarize my?
Yes.
Well, we were thinking of creating a condition. I don't mean to interrupt you.
No, please.
Creating a condition of approval that would say that all the parking remains shared parking and not designated for the apartments.
Yeah,
okay.
No signs up.
With no signs.
No signs.
Apparently, there are other parking lots in town that are supposed to be shared parking and are, in fact, shared parking, but nevertheless, the people mostly in control of them have put up signs saying, you know, don't park here unless. And those of us who don't know any better, like myself, don't park there.
No, I actually, in a lot of our projects, I have requests to actually go the other way, to designate it. It doesn't, the shared parking arrangement does not work if you start putting signs up.
The numbered parking places seems to work extremely well in the places that I visit on a regular basis.
So when you're marketing these, you won't assign parking lots to any particular unit? Yeah, okay.
So with pediatric dental, we included this condition number 3. And it was no problem. I want to say MRV, but I guess it must have been South Village LLC.
Can you zoom in on that?
I'm sorry. It says, prior to issuance of a zoning permit, the applicant shall execute and record a permanent easement with South Village LLC, which kind of controls this PUD, giving permission to locate parking spaces, sidewalks, and landscaping on the PUD common land. And that was no problem for them, and they gave that easement, and it wasn't...
There is no common land, is there, Jan?
There's a vast majority of this development is common land.
Because you'll have trees over in the common land.
Pretty much, because of the way that the lot line was redrawn on this for the Village Walk project, we're not changing those lot lines. And so actually, any of the infrastructure that we're going to be building around this building, the sidewalk, trees, and everything, is actually all on my, is on the lot that I'm purchasing.
Oh, good. I'm glad you came back in, then.
Yes. If I, I guess it doesn't need clarification, but...
Yeah.
So is this the lot line here?
So, yeah.
Goes around like this and curves down?
Yeah, the lot line is larger. It actually incorporates part of the old, the green spaces in the middle and up to the other side of the building.
Well, it's kind of a swale there.
Yes, yeah.
Which doesn't jive with our parcel maps.
Right.
So when you guys looked at the aerial photo on the front page of this staff packet, you were looking at an old parcel boundary.
Right.
Right.
That was corrected since our parcel maps have been updated, so sorry for that confusion.
I don't recall any discussion that had too much to do with the parcel except for the historical parking comparison.
So no condition about the easement, because that's not really applicable the way it was with the dental, right?
Yeah, I know. Well, no, they don't.
Looks like all your trees are going to be on the lot.
Yes.
And as far as parking, I know there's spaces over here, but your shared parking condition kind of covers that, right?
I'm sure this board originally approved all of the association documents, declarations, bylaws. I'm sure it was reviewed once upon a time. And as a lot owner, I'm automatically part of that. Those documents are basically held to the restrictions and covenants and easements that are recorded in benefit of those documents as well.
And of the original conditions on the Act 250 permit, which I'm sure would cover lighting, right? Downward direct light.
Yeah, I'm sure you're amending that permit.
Yeah, it's a standard.
So did they ever actually have their Act 250 permit?
They did.
For this project?
Yeah.
It was issued.
The village, well, Middlebury South Village, obviously, and then Village Walk did as well.
They did.
Okay.
They had all their permits in place and were ready for construction.
Okay.
All of the permits in a 50-degree February are in place to begin construction.
We good? We good with these guys now?
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Glad you're still there.
5 more minutes, we'll get you.
No, go. Run.
Well, thank you. That makes our job easier to go over those conditions as a board.
Are we on the number 3?
Yes.
Because I'm going to recuse myself that moment and leave.
Wait a minute.
So he's not going to do it.
Okay.
Bathroom break.
Gary leaving us?
Should we take a little break?
Okay, we'll take a 5-minute break.